So how's everyone doing today? Yeah, good? Ooh, I think it was really good. So just kind of without further ado, let's set the stage here. This is a talk about performance, with performance being the manner in which a mechanism behaves. I was conducting some accessibility auditing last year, which is the process of performing manual and automated checks to see if a website can work with assistive technology. The client was a medical education app and was used to train caregivers, including nurses and doctors. And it was built using a single-page application framework, using Google's Material Design Library to build the user interface. When I learned that, I thought, Google made it. Oh, sweet. I don't have to worry as much. So I fire up VoiceOver, which is macOS's screen reader, and I start testing. And things are going pretty well, and then VoiceOver crashes. I can do that. I try restarting Safari. I try clearing cache. I try closing other tabs. I even try rebooting, you know, that old chestnut. And it's the same result every time. So I ask my boss what's going on, and he says, oh, it's probably problems with the accessibility tree. And I say, the what now? And before I get more into this, here's a question for y'all. How do you describe an interface? And I'm not saying, tell me what you see or hear when you turn the computer on. I'm saying, how do you speak computer to a computer? The way we do that is with the accessibility tree. And fundamentally, the accessibility tree is a collection of objects, all the atomic bits that are used to make up the user interface. People who rely on assistive technology use the accessibility tree to navigate and take action on user interfaces. So without a functioning accessibility tree, there is no way to describe the current state of what an interface is, and consequently, no way for some people to be able to use a computer or a smartphone. So suffice to say, this is a really important piece of technology. So how do you go about building one? How do you build an accessibility tree? First, you have to give each individual object in an interface a name. Names are short identifiers used to describe purpose. Then you give it a role. Roles are predefined values that tell someone what they can do to an interface object. For example, a role of a button means that someone can press it to activate some predefined action. And these properties, which are the attributes of these objects, examples of this are its position in an interface, its state, or interactions that are allowed. For a button, that could mean a toggled state to indicate that it is being pressed in, say like the play button on a media player. Finally, we have a description, which can provide further information about the object if needed. These accessible objects are then programmatically grouped together to form more complicated interface components. So, how do you build these interface components? Let's say an operating system alert dialog. That's a pretty commonplace thing for UI. Starting from the top down, we have a menu bar, and that's the anchor that we're going to attach everything to. And then we add a title for the menu bar so we know what it's all about and what contents we can expect to find. And if you're using a screen reader, titles are really helpful as it saves you from having to dig around inside the component to figure out what it's for. We might also need to close this dialog once we learn what it's for, so we include a close button, and then we add the body of the dialog. This is the place where we place the bulk of the dialog content. In the dialog's body, there's another title, which asks us if we want to save the changes we made to the thing we're working on. Then we add the text to the body, which will provide more information about what happens if you choose not to save. Then we add a save button that allows us to commit to saving the changes we made, and an accompanying cancel button in case we don't. And presto, we have a dialog component. Because these collected objects have accessible names and are therefore present in the accessibility tree, we can speak computer to computer to get what we want. I can programmatically say, go to the dialog, then its body, and activate the save button. It works. How cool is that? So this might seem a little pedantic, but please bear with me for a bit. This is the polar bear from the show Polar Bear Cafe. It's lovely and wonderful if you haven't seen it. It's also a terrible pun, I'm sorry. We do have this dialogue component, but there's more to it than just that. Interface components have to have a place to live, and that place is an operating system. Operating systems also include components that allow us to navigate to and access the stuff you store in them. It's also the place where we install and run programs, and all the little doodads and widgets and games that we can't live without. Then we also have the browser, which is rapidly becoming an operating system in its own right. And the browser contains the mechanisms we use to access the web. And the web is sort of like the Wild West, in that you can write more or less whatever you want, and it'll usually work, which is honestly both a blessing and a curse. But regardless of how you write what you write, you can't escape the fact that you ultimately have to create HTML. That HTML then has its appearance and behavior augmented by both JavaScript and CSS. Again, there's many ways to go about doing this, but they are the other two requisite parts that make up the whole that is a website or a web app. The HTML markup, augmented by both JavaScript and CSS, creates the document object model, or DOM tree, which is a programming interface for websites. Browsers then read the DOM and all the information contained within it to draw an interface, which is then shown to the user, which is you. The user can then take actions, which updates the DOM, which in turn updates what is visually rendered, allowing us to make our websites dynamic. That's pretty cool. Running in parallel to all this is the accessibility tree, which is sampled from the generated DOM. And I say sampled because the accessibility tree will use specialized heuristics to only surface things it deems necessary. Modern versions of the accessibility tree are generated after styles are computed. Important note, as certain CSS properties such as display and pseudo-element content will actually affect it. This sampled version of the DOM is then read by various kinds of assistive technology, including, but not limited to, just screen readers. And there's two kind of important things I'd like to point out here. First, using a visually rendered interface and assistive technology aren't mutually exclusive. This can be a case of, say, a low-vision user who is also operating a narrator while they're visually browsing. And then, not all screen reader users are blind. Also, many people choose to augment their browsing experience with devices that rely on the accessibility tree that you would not consider traditional accessibility devices. Again, it's a way for us to speak computer to computer. Secondly, the accessibility tree relies on the user interacting with the DOM to update. And because of this, it's effectively a read-only technology, meaning that, for right now, we can't work directly with it. There's a little bit of work on that front. It's still pretty new. I wouldn't expect it for a few years. Another thing you should be aware of is that it's more of an accessibility forest than it is an accessibility tree. There are different implementations of the accessibility tree. Each depends on which operating system you're using and what version of said operating system is running. This is due to the different ways companies have built and updated their operating system's underlying code throughout the years. And just so we're clear, the DOM can be a part of the accessibility tree, but the accessibility tree is larger and not limited to just the contents of your browser. Because of this, the accessibility tree is more brittle. It has more to pay attention to, and its technical architecture was developed before this whole internet thing really took off, meaning it didn't anticipate the sheer amount of information we'd be throwing at it. Crashing the accessibility tree, and therefore breaking assistive technology support, is bad, yes. But a large amount of information present in the DOM means that there's an accompanying large amount of work the accessibility tree needs to do to figure out what's important within that, and then report on it to the user, which slows it down. This can create a lack of synchronization between the current state of the page and what is being reported by assistive technology, meaning that a user may not be working with an accurate model of the screen and be taking action on interactive components that are no longer present. This can create the confusing experience of activating the wrong control or navigating to a place they didn't intend to. Another version of this is when you have a slow loading website, you go to click the cancel button, and then it loads that last little blob JavaScript, pops in, you hit save instead, and now you spend $40 on something you never meant to. It's exactly like that. So, how do we help prevent this? You start with writing semantic HTML. Using things like the button element for buttons, instead of aria slapped onto a div, helps lessen the amount of guesswork the accessibility tree has to do when it runs heuristics to slot meaningful content into its description of the current state of things. This serves to both speed up calculation and makes what it reports more reliable. And speaking of semantic HTML, here's the raw living DOM tree of an actual website. In fact, it is the homepage for this conference. Even a static, performant website contains a lot of information the computer has to chew through. And again, utilizing semantic HTML helps to reduce the effort it takes to generate the accessibility tree. And unfortunately, using semantic HTML is kind of a rare thing these days, which is partly why I'm here giving this talk. So actually, thank you to WordCamp for keeping their markup both straightforward and semantic. It's really appreciated. All right, I think you've got the gist of it. Of the code I just showed you, five slides worth, we've only covered two-thirds of just one page. And it's worth pointing out that this is a relatively short page, and that again, this is a lot of information to process. And keeping that DOM tree example in mind, we now have a simple form. It's a pair of unstyled radio buttons asking you if you want the chicken or the fish as your meal preference. Here's how that form might be translated into the accessibility tree. You have a field set element which wraps a legend, which says meal preference, and two inputs with types of radio, names of chicken and fish, and the chicken option has been pre-selected to true. Finally, within the field set, there is a button with the name of save. Again, these are the accessible objects with names, roles, kind of all that good stuff coming right on back. And you can see here, if we use semantic HTML, these names, roles, and properties are automatically filled in for us without any additional effort. And when I was speaking about how semantic HTML slots in, this is exactly what I'm getting at. And here's a more high-fidelity example, sampled again from the conference homepage. I'm using Firefox's Accessibility Inspector to dig into a text node. And there's a ton more information exposed, including attributes, states, actions, a child element count, relations, and available actions. All of this data is used by the accessibility tree to help it describe the shape of things. And here's an even more high-fidelity example. And this is a raw text dump of the accessibility tree for this same page. This is an example of what the language might look like when we're speaking machine directly to machine. We don't speak machine directly, though. Before we had Firefox's Accessibility Inspector, we had to rely on more specialized tools to help us be translators. The Pacello Group's A-Viewer and Apple's Accessibility Inspector are the two go-to resources here, and you're still going to need them if you want to inspect anything other than websites, or if you need to do some really serious digging. So, let's make the abstract immediate here. What's going on, and why should you care? With my auditing project, I narrow the problem down to issues with Material Design's radio inputs. And here's how they appear visually. And here's how they appear in code. To make a Material Design radio input, you need six HTML elements containing nine attributes with a DOM depth of 3. You also need 66 CSS selectors containing 141 properties, which weighs in at 10K when minified. You also need 2,374 lines of JavaScript, which weighs in at 30K minified. And all that will get us a radio input. But you need more than one radio input to be able to use it properly. And oftentimes, there's a few options to select from. Sometimes there's more than just a few options. And sometimes there's even more than that. In the case of my audit, we had a ton of radio inputs being conditionally injected into the page. And the point of this being is it all adds up. Google's Lighthouse Project, an open source tool that analyzes your website for performance problems, recommends an optimal website DOM tree has the following. Less than 1,500 nodes, a max depth of 32 nodes, and no parent node with more than 60 child nodes. What I'd like to call attention to is the max depth of 32 nodes bit. This might seem like a lot of wiggle room at first, but take a moment and think about all the templates of the sites you've worked on. There's the frame set, there's wrapper divs, landmarks, component wrappers, and if you're doing it right, field sets on your forms. And each one digs a little bit more inward. Another part of accessibility auditing is providing a fix to the problems you uncover. It's difficult work, but nobody likes to pay people money to tell them all their things that are wrong, but then offer no solutions. I wish it was. We wound up recommending a radio input pattern that utilized three HTML elements. It's a pattern developed by my friend Scott, taken from his excellent A11Y style form controls project. It's worth saying that Scott puts these patterns through their paces and tests them with an incredibly robust set of assistive technologies. So a nice side benefit is knowing I can recommend his solutions with confidence. Visually, it was completely indistinguishable from the original version. And to compare the two solutions, we have a 50% reduction in HTML elements, and we've cut the DOM depth down by a third. There's also a 30% reduction in CSS selectors and properties, resulting in the CSS payload for this pattern being reduced by 90%. We've also completely removed 30K of JavaScript, which is 30K less blocking resource being served to the user. And cobbling up a rough prototype, we were able to create an environment that mimicked the conditions of the site we were auditing, only this time using the new radio input code. And guess what? It worked. VoiceOver didn't crash. So why is this our problem? Why should we care about the fragility of other people's software? Well, prioritizing developer ergonomics without considering the generated HTML can lead to bad things happening. And regardless of our setup, we tend to pile even more things onto our base experience. Things like ads, analytics, social marketing engagement tools, and development integration utilities. And then there's also this cold war raging between websites and their users. Here is Facebook splitting a single word into 11 DOM elements to avoid ad blockers. And this graph is generated from the median values of how 1.3 million websites are generated, with JavaScript claiming the majority of the share. This JavaScript majority means that it's much more time spent blocking the browser from performing other actions, including things like interfacing with assistive technologies. When we throw out what the browser gives us for free, we oftentimes don't realize there are very real, very important things we sacrifice in doing so. Here's what Marco Zaghi, Mozilla's senior accessibility QA engineer, has to say about this. Nibbling away at those milliseconds it takes for information to reach assistive technologies when requested, my current task is to reduce the number of accessible objects we create for HTML div elements. This is to reduce the size of the accessibility tree, emphasis mine. This reduces the amount of data being transferred across process boundaries. Part of what makes Firefox accessibility slower on Windows since Firefox Quantum is the fact that assistive technologies now no longer have direct access to the accessible tree of the document. A lot of it needs to be fetched across a process boundary, so the amount of data that needs to be fetched actually matters a lot now. Reducing that by filtering out objects we don't need is a good way to reduce the time it takes for information to reach assistive technologies. This is particularly true in dynamically updating environments like Gmail, Twitter, or Mastodon. My current patch, slated to land in early Firefox 67 cycle, shaves off about 10 to 20% of the time it takes for certain calls to return. Note that all this optimization is only for one browser, Firefox. The patch has landed. And that there are a lot of browsers out there. It's also not all about browsers either. Here is a refreshable Braille display, one of the many other kinds of assistive technology that interfaces with the accessibility tree. It does not have a lot of hardware on it, it does not have a lot of computational power. And so, someone should do something. The battle cry of bystanders everywhere. Let's unpack this some, and let's figure out our available options. For screen readers, the main ones are JAWS and NVDA, both are Windows screen readers, and VoiceOver for macOS and iOS, and TalkBack for Android as well. These are the four big screen readers you're going to hear about, and it's sort of analogous to Chrome, Safari, Firefox, and IE, in that there's more screen readers and assistive technology out there, but these cover the main use cases you're likely to deal with. While not all assistive technology are screen readers, if your site works well with a screen reader, chances are good it'll work well for other assistive tech. Of them, all but one have an open issue tracker, but half have closed source code. This means that while we can file issues, we aren't really empowered empowered to do much more about it on the assistive technology layer. It also means that it's a completely unrealistic expectation for people to submit and follow up issues and then create code pull requests across all trackers in addition to working a full-time job. Our only other realistic option is to keep the DOM trees of our sites nice and shallow, and that there are actual tangible benefits to doing this. Here's Marco again weighing in on his optimization efforts. Reducing the number of milliseconds it takes for a screen reader to start speaking after a key press from about 140 to 100 here, or from 120 to 100 there, doesn't matter much on a fast machine. On a slow machine, that reduction is from about 230 to 250 milliseconds down to 200 or 190. Let's talk about what a slow machine means now. If you are disabled and or underserved, you face significant barriers to entering and staying in the workforce. This means you may have less access to current technology, especially the more expensive, higher quality versions of it. Another factor is some people who rely on assistive technology are very reluctant to upgrade it for a justified fear of breaking the way they used to interact with the world. Slow machines may not also mean an ancient computer. Inexpensive Android smartphones are a common entry point for emerging markets, and with Android comes talkback. A slow machine might also come from a place you may not be expecting, by which I mean you have a state-of-the-art machine and therefore are doing state-of-the-art things on it. This requires a ton of computational resources, which makes fast things slow. With less computational resources to go around, we may have unintended consequences, possibly recreating a situation similar to our too many radio inputs problem. You know, like, let's think Electron apps, which are desktop programs that are built using web technologies. Here we have Atom, VS Code, Slack, Skype, WhatsApp, and Discord. These are all built using Electron. So, accessibility auditing isn't something that people normally do out of the goodness of their own heart. It's typically performed after a lawsuit has been levied against an organization. And let me be clear here, when you create inaccessible experiences, you are denying people their civil rights. The Americans with Disabilities Act guarantees that people cannot be discriminated against based on their disability conditions. And this extends to both private organizations and the digital space. We had an excellent talk about this earlier today. I see you in the audience, hello. And this is a good thing, as it guarantees protections as more and more of the services necessary to living your everyday life go online. Think of your future self. You will age. Your vision will start to go. Your mobility will start to decrease. You need to work with what you have and kind of not what you hope will be. And part of this means understanding that when we want things to be better, we need to understand that these kinds of changes are really technically complicated under the hood and spread across multiple concerns. On top of that, accessibility fixes are often viewed as unglamorous and deprioritized compared to other features. And if you don't believe me, here's the support matrix for the title attribute incorporated into the W3C's HTML spec in 1993. It's 26 years later, and we still have a ton of interoperability problems. I don't need to bum you out, and I don't expect you to all become accessibility experts. However, as people who are interested in more than just the surface level of things, you are all uniquely empowered to affect positive change. What I ask of you is to at least incorporate basic accessibility testing into your workflow. If anything, just check to see if a screen reader crashes. A bad assistive technology experience is better than none at all. Okay, the background on the slide is yellow now, and this is what we call a great segue. I'm a designer by trade, and part of that job means coming up with alternate strategies for allowing people to accomplish their goals. Because sometimes the most effective solution isn't necessarily the most obvious one. With that in mind, we're going to talk about another definition of performance, which is the ability to actually accomplish something. All these little surgical tweaks and optimizations and code fixes don't mean squat if people don't understand how to operate the really fast thing you just gave them. Another aspect of dynamically injecting a ton of radio inputs into a page is that it adds more things for a person to think about. This is called cognitive load, and it's a huge problem. It affects our ability to accomplish tasks, and importantly, our ability to accomplish tasks accurately. Namely, it inhibits our memory, our problem-solving skills, our attention, our reading comprehension level, our math comprehension level, and shockingly, our ability to actually understand what we see. It's such an important problem that NASA developed the Task Load Index, an assessment tool to help quantify it. This isn't warm, fuzzy feelings about empathy. This is a serious attempt by a government agency to refine efficiencies and prevent errors. And one of the most interesting things about the existence of the Task Load Index is that it's an admission from a government organization that disability conditions can be conditional. Think about it. When's the last time you were tired, or distracted, or sick, or depressed, or learning a new skill? Now, heck, when's the last time you were drunk? Cognitive load is an important thing to track for building rockets, sure, but it also translates to other complicated things, like making and using software. One of the things we can do to lessen cognitive load is to lessen the amount of information someone has to parse at any given moment. For our medical education app, we could have added an additional step to the user flow that asks a high-level segmenting question. It's a little bit more friction and a little bit more work, sure, but it's being used strategically to as a focused choice to help keep the cognitive load lower at what you're doing at any given moment. This would help to filter down the results you get, which makes it both easier for the browser and for the person using it to parse. The other big picture question we need to ask is if all this work is even necessary. The most performant page is the one you never have to use, by which I mean how often can we sidestep these issues by using other resources and information made available to us. If you're interested in this sort of thing, the 2018 Design and Tech Report is a must-read piece. One of the things it revealed was that surprisingly very few companies conduct qualitative user research, which is the fancy-sounding phrase for the practice of asking people how they use a feature and how they feel while they do it. Weird idea, I know. And that's 12% early-stage startups, 32% mid-stage startups, and 46% large late-stage startups that start to invest in conducting qualitative user research. I'm not a numbers person, but there does kind of seem to be a trend going on here. And another interesting thing the report revealed is that barely any companies are conducting qualitative user testing for features after launching them. So we're all just collectively throwing features into the larger, ever-evolving ecosystems that are our products, and not checking to see how it'll affect the things that are already there, which is weird. As consumers, we also need to remember that we're only seeing those companies that beat the odds. The market is built on top of the corpses of failed businesses who poured all their cash and all their resources into the wrong features and backing the wrong ideas. So, the second big ask from this talk is really just repeating the first one. It's one thing to read about something and believe it to be true, but it's another thing entirely to put it out into the world without verifying that it works. The web, and more importantly, the people who use it, are too important not to. Thank you for your time. Thank you to our transcriber, and thank you to WordCamp and its organizers and staff for this opportunity. The slides for this presentation, including the references and resources I used to make it, are available on Notice, and my contact information is available on my website, as well as my Twitter. If you have any questions, I'd love to hear from you, either following this talk, or even come find me after this and yell at me about all the things that don't work on your website. Thank you.